This is Pastor Aubrey, the senior pastor of Race for Purpose Ministries, popularly abbreviated as RFP. I want to specially invite you to be a part of this that God is doing in this end time, to be part of the army, to be part of the strategy of God in this end times. You can be a part of us by attending our weekly services and weekly programs. You can be streaming our services live, or you can be listening to them at any time. We are on different platforms. We are on YouTube, we are on Facebook, we are on Mixer and many other platforms. Some of the details are those that are showing on the screen. We are physically in almost every district in Malawi, and even outside Malawi, you can get in touch with us and we'll let you know where RFP is. You know, RFP is home, and is home for you and home for me. Be a part of what God is doing. I'll be looking forward to seeing you. God bless you. Are you ready for the word of God for today? Are you sure? We are talking about foundational truth on marriage. Foundational truth on marriage. I thought of bringing it, you know, in this Sunday service, and I said that those that don't want to hear about it could attend first service, where I'm teaching about unleashing your destined glory. Okay, but I find it important to also tackle these topics right in the service, as opposed to preparing a special conference on a Saturday or a seminar somewhere, because there are certain aspects that help everyone, including those that are not in marriage, whether separated, divorce, or widow, widower, whatever it is. These subjects end up helping everyone. So as you listen today, know that whatever state or status you are at, this subject will still help you. Are you there? We started last week talking about what I refer to as the most important foundation. And that foundation is the foundation of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter number 3 and verse 11 tells us that. He says that, "For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." So it's telling us that the first most important foundation for everybody, not only on areas of marriage, not only in business, not only in career, not only in health, not only in whatever area you can imagine, the Bible tells us the most important foundation is the foundation of Jesus Christ. If you don't build this foundation well, whatever you are building upon it is not as important. The foundation of a building is very important. You can build strong pillars. You can build a strong roof. You can build strong walls. But if the foundation is not good, that building can still collapse. That's what the Bible tells us about one that built on the sand and another that built on a rock. The point there was the foundation. So the first foundation you must build for your life, not only for marriage, for your life, is the foundation of Jesus Christ. It has been researched, it has been known, and even I have experienced it with the many people that we deal with. Those that are spiritually mature end up having good families. Those that are spiritually mature end up having so many things that work well. Because there is a level of maturity that you need when you're dealing with people. Dealing with people, generally, people can easily give you headaches. Whether it is you giving the other a headache, or it's the other giving you, or you are distributing headaches, exchanging headaches. But as much as we are in a world of people, people will easily wrong you, people will anger you. And when people are wronging you, they are not always doing it deliberately. You know that? Someone can offend you, not out of that it was their plan to offend you, but it's human, it's part of us, that one day you can offend another. So I mean, for example, crack a joke and say, you know, there are some people that maybe they fail. Maybe they fail to even cook chips, for example. That's the example. I'm saying there are some people that fail to cook chips. And it may just be that this morning he failed to cook chips. At that point, it may look like I am targeting him. Or let's say I say something like, some people, they can't be man enough to live, you know, to lead a successful marriage. And this is the mistake they do. And as I'm saying that, suppose him, just before this service, he had contacted the zone pastor and explained the situation about their marriage. And exactly what he's saying is exactly what I come in the service and I said. You know what you think? What you think is, he told the zone pastor. The zone pastor has told me. And I have decided not to act honorably. I have decided to come respond to it in the service. He can be offended, isn't it? Yet for me, it was a random example. You see? So such things happen. And people can easily wrong each other. That's why it requires spiritual maturity to live well with people. Even you, I'm telling you, many of you wrong me. Many times, actually, some of you. Many times. And some of you even know it. Someone was just apologizing to me on something on Telegram. I said, Pastor, I'm just sorry. You know, you told us not to do this, but I did it. Hey, Pastor, I wronged you. Sorry. I said, no, it's fine. So people keep wronging you. But it takes spiritual maturity. That as people are wronging you, as someone is stoning Stephen, Stephen looks into the air. Heaven opens. And Stephen says, Lord, forgive them. They know not what they are doing. It takes spiritual maturity. It takes spiritual maturity in church that someone does wrong to you and you are able to look aside. And say, though this person has wronged me, I'm a Christian. I think beyond these things. This is not Jesus' crucifixion on the cross. This is way less than it. I make up my mind to still love this person no matter what. It takes spiritual maturity. Not many are like that. And I'll tell you, when you now, let's say, you are working with people in a team, or you are a leader, or you are in business, or even in marriage, the same applies. Your wife will wrong you. Your husband will wrong you. It takes spiritual maturity that your husband wrongs you. And you say, okay, it has happened. It is well. Let's move on. Take spiritual maturity. That's why there are many babes in Christ that somehow these toddlers have found themselves into marriage. And they react over everything and anything. Why is the marriage not working? It's not working because the necessary maturity that must be there for you to be able to absorb the pressures of marriage is not there. Marriage comes with its own pressures, isn't it? Some people, you can't even absorb the pressures in a relationship. Relationship where you meet here and there, where someone sends you a text on WhatsApp and you can choose to pretend you haven't seen it at that time, and you have got all the time to cool down before you answer it. You are talking marriage, you are there. So if you are not answering, the other one can even say you are not answering. The story can even be you are not answering. Whereas only. So if you can't handle pressures in a relationship, what more with pressures in marriage? But also, some of you, it's not even in relationships. You can't even handle having a friend. You know that there are some people that they can't even keep one friend for a year. They will part ways. Like they will divorce the friend. They can't have a friend for 1 year. And they are surprised how some of us have had friends. Like, I don't think I have been losing any friends. Okay, they may change that some people, you become closer to them, maybe because you are in the same location, same country, or you are rubbing shoulders, bumping into each other more often, like that. But not enemies where you are, it's possible with you to quarrel with someone. And so I quarrel with him. And by the end of the matter, never talk to me again. Never. 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 Stupid. You know, like the Nigerians, idiot. And like a Christian? No. The problem is not that person. The problem is you. You always have a choice on how to react. Actually, you can react or you can respond. And how you react or respond depends on your maturity. If you are a mature person, someone may do wrong to you. The way you handle the matter, very different from another person that is immature. That's why, number one, if I was just to select one and we close there, I would just say, be mature, you have it sorted in life. If you are spiritually mature, you have it sorted in marriage. You have it sorted in your finances. You have it sorted every other area. Oh, but pastor, we have seen many mature people that they are mature, but they still do ABC. Maturity is not an assumption. The fact that they are doing ABC, that means they are not mature. How did Apostle Paul know that these ones were mature, these ones were not? 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. He says that, when I came to you, I could not talk unto you as unto mature, but as unto babes. How did he know they were babes? He says, for whereas there is among you strife, quarreling, divisions, all of this, are ye not acting like mere men? Are you not carnal? So how do you know maturity? You know maturity by what is being released. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth what? Speaketh. The things you have been speaking, it's not like, hey, it's just a slip of the tongue. No, the tongue never slips on things that are not inside. Whatever slipped out, it's just, what it was there. It was around the neck. It was on the throat. It's just that you know where you release it. So it has just slipped out at the wrong destination or at the wrong environment. Have you heard people that say, hey, I'm dead. Hey. Then they realize that they are amongst people of faith. Hey, no, I'm not dead. I meant, hey, it's a very funny thing. Okay, so why should you say you are dead? Can't you just say it's funny? You know, it's funny. I find it funny, then laugh. Why should you say it has killed me? The joke has killed you. What a confession. And if a joke can kill you, what more with the devil? Are you there? So number one, spiritual maturity. You know, for me, when I want to go to length with this topic, you know, it's just that when you're preaching in church, you want to balance people of different, maturity levels. So you have to be careful what you say and what not to say. But for me, if you look at the extreme of spiritual maturity, you can marry anyone. As long as the two of you are spiritually mature, even if you married the wrong person, as in, oh Lord, who should I marry? This sister or that brother, oh, the Lord show me. Yes, when the Lord shows you, do it, that's perfect. But with spiritual maturity, you can just marry anyone in Christ. It will still work. You want verses on it. Like, the verses are many. The problem is not the person you found. That there is no chemistry. There is no much. When mature people meet up, the maturity is the chemistry. Didn't you see that when Mary and Elizabeth met, on the inside of them, Jesus and John the Baptist, they lived with joy. The chemistry is the maturity. Oh. But you know, I wouldn't want to go there. I don't want to mislead anyone. But are you there? So I'm talking about spiritual marriage. I'm talking to all ages. Those not married, even those married. Even if you have been married for 20 years, 50 years, spiritual maturity is still key. People are divorcing as grandparents. And you wonder. People divorce at 70. At 70. Hey. That's why people should change the question from, you know, you look like you have money and you are settled. When are you marrying? They should say, you look like you are mature. You appear you are spiritually mature. When are you getting married? Not you look like you have money. Because there are many with money that are not mature. That's why we hear that some people, someone sent me this story, that someone owe his money and property were in the name of his mother. Including, they say, 80% of his salary is kept by the mother. That's another thing now. You mean you can't trust your wife? The wife you married. So the wife thought we have things. Just to find out we didn't have things. And even look at the wife. The wife waited for divorce to know that we didn't have things. This is also a kind of a wife. A kind of a man, a kind of a lady. That's why they were attracted to each other. Okay, let's go for number two. So number one, we have said spiritual maturity. Number two, I said knowledge. Knowledge is very, very important. 1 Peter chapter number 3, verse 7. Let's rush. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. The Bible says, likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge. So it says, husbands, dwell with your wives according to knowledge. And we saw it from last week that the knowledge there is the word gnosis. And gnosis, like G-N-O-S-I-S, gnosis. Gnosis refers to scientific knowledge or common knowledge. Gnosis means that this is white. Let's call it white. That this is white. Anyone can see it that this is white. It's not debate. My suit is blue. So anyone can see it that this is blue. There is no need for revelation here. This is knowledge that you can access, that anyone can access. So the Bible says, you husbands, live with your wives not according to revelations and visions and dreams. On a minimum, live with them according to knowledge. By extension, the same way. Wives, live with your husbands according to knowledge. Two things that we see there. Number one, it says that to dwell with them according to knowledge should mean that if you want, and I'm telling you, this is a very great spiritual principle. And a very great life principle. It shows us that if you want the best in life, the best result from something, then you ought to handle or work with that thing according to knowledge. In other words, something only brings out its very best if the way you handle it, the way you live with it, the way you dwell with it, is consistent with knowledge that brings out the best from it. So if you are working with a car, you must work with a car according to knowledge. If you handle the car according to most superior knowledge on handling a car, the car will give you the best of results. If you take flour, powder, whatever, all these ingredients, if you work with them according to knowledge, you produce the best cake. Whatever you work with, based on or consistent to knowledge, that produces the best of results. And then, number two, that's also telling us that, remember, the husband is a man. The wife is a woman. Apart from the, what you may look at it as, husband and wife, is also telling us that generally, men and women are different. And this is where I want to start with. Men and women are generally different. They don't become different when they enter into marriage. If you get this, what I'm teaching, very carefully, you can end up becoming a very good manager in the workplace. You can become a very good boss in the workplace. You can become a very good leader. Because as a leader, under you, there are men. Under you, there are ladies. As a leader, if you understand the differences between men and women, you also know how to handle them accordingly. If you assume that as long as I am the boss, everyone under me is the same, it doesn't work. Even me as a pastor and as a leader, I don't deal with all of you the same way. There is a way I deal with ladies. There is a way I deal with men. I recognize the differences that are there. There are things that inspire a woman to work hard in ministry. There are things that inspire a man to work hard in ministry. If you assume they are exactly the same ways, that one leadership style will fit all of them, it won't work. As a parent, there is a way on how to develop, minister to a boy, and also a way on how you can develop or minister to your girl in the house. If you generalize and say, all of us are the same, all of us are the same, you handle your boy the same way you handle the girl, it won't work. Are you listening? If all your friends, you handle them the same way, it won't work. Me have noticed, even in dealing with people in institutions or different places, I've noticed if you know the differences between men and women and you act accordingly, you are going to get a lot of help, a lot of assistance. If you don't know, you are going to learn it the hard way. Even the policeman on the road, when it's a lady, there is what to do. When it's a man, there is what to do if you are in the wrong. You know? I also learned it the hard way years ago. I was in a rush, and this woman policeman stopped me. This police lady stopped me and had said, let me see the COF. So at that time, road traffic, whatever happened to the system, they weren't printing COFs from the system. So they were given this A4 paper type of a thing. It was valid for 1 month or something. So I pulled out that one. And I showed that lady. So the lady told me, yes, this is valid for 1 month. But the system has now started working after 1 week. So it was supposed to not work for 1 month, but after 1 week they fixed it. So I said, okay. Then I said, then it's valid. Let me go. The story changed from COF to, are you speaking like that to me because I'm a lady? I said, no. I'm just saying this paper is valid for 1 month. The COF is not a paper. The car was tested. The car passed. This is the certificate of fitness. The car passed. This is the paper. I said, you're talking to me like that because I'm a lady. If I was, the story changed. I'm telling you, we stayed there for some minutes until they took my license, they took what? I just proceeded. I think later on it was Pastor Jonathan and someone that had to go collect them for me, and they had to pay. The point was, you are looking at me as a lady. So I understood that ladies, there is a way that you must do it. That was years ago, but I learned my lesson over the years. When you do something wrong, because sometimes you can do something slightly wrong, isn't it? And sometimes you may not even know. But when you do something wrong on the road and it's a lead, there is a way to do it. Just highly esteem that lady. If you are a man, I'm telling you, like you can drop off the car and praise her. Like you can kneel and she will let you go. Once you appear, are you there? So there is a way that you handle men and you handle ladies. If it is a man on the road and you did something wrong, how do you think you handle a man? Men go with logic, eh? Just explain whatever happened. Explain the situation, brother. Men can take it from that way without adding emotions, without whatever. It can be sorted. I'll tell you, even when you go to any government institution, watch out. On the reception, is it a lady? Behave yourself. Is it a man? There is also a way to do it. Are you following? What I'm trying to bring to you is, this works everywhere in life, even in church. Some leaders, you end up being bad leaders because you are handling everyone the same way. So for example, the way Pastor Emma may handle Pastor Mpaso and the way Pastor Emma may handle Pastor Queen should be very different. Should be very different. Once it's the same way of handling them, I'll tell you, one of them will be offended. Are you following? Are you following? So these differences that I'll list out for you, they are not only in marriage. These work everywhere else. And as well as in marriage, of course. One of the challenges that we have when people are getting into relationships or marriage is that they have strong expectations that their partner will be just like them. So they think their partner will be just like them in terms of attitude, will be like them in terms of values, will be like them in terms of perceptions, and will be like them in terms of behaviors. Attitudes, values, perceptions, behaviors. So when people are getting into marriage, the lady thinks that this man thinks like me, views things like me, behaves like me, analyzes things like me. Yet, it's very different. Okay? And that's why it's very, very important to educate yourself in the basic gender differences between men and women. You educate yourself. You study them. You know them. Why? Because you must accept them the way they are. It is real. It will remain real. It will be like that. That's the way men are. That's the way women are. When you understand them, then you know how to bring out the best from them. If you don't want to understand them, you end up dealing with a lady the way you deal with a man, it won't bring the same results. It won't bring the same results. Are you following? Genesis chapter number 1, verse 27. We saw there, the Bible tells us on how God created man in his own image. And the Bible says he created them male and female. So God created them together, male and female. Created them in the spirit, created them together. They are one, they are the same. The man is not superior to the lady. Neither is the lady superior to the man. However, they have got, remember, they were created in God's image and God's likeness. So as the image of God, they express God. But the way a man expresses God in a certain way. Then a lady also expresses God in another way. Remember what Ezekiel shows us and John also shows us in Revelations. I don't want to go into those scriptures. But remember, they saw on the throne what looked like, number one, he said, had the face of a man. Number two, had the face of a lion. Number three, had the face of an ox. Number four, had the face of an eagle. Showing us that when you see God, within God, there are many similarities with man. When you see the same God, the face of an eagle. The same God, the same of an ox. What does an ox do? Like cow, ox. What does it do? A bull, what does it do? Most people use it to serve. And so, let's say they use it to plow or whatever, or they keep them for animals. It's a picture of servanthood. That's why Jesus came as a perfect example of servanthood. They did this, they did that. He never responded. He kept on working until he went to the cross and died. The face of an ego. An ego sees far. That's why the Bible says he endured the cross. He says, seeing this for the joy that was set before him, he saw into the future. The Bible says he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days. So there are different aspects in God. The same way, part of these aspects, God chose it that he may express some of them via a man. He may express some of them via a woman. That's why we are different. We are all expressing certain aspects of God. Are you there? The problem is, each gender feels, and these days they like to call it the other gender. Every gender thinks that we do it the right way. No. You are just expressing a certain part of God that the other gender is not expressing. When a lady is crying, people think, ladies are weak, they are too soft, they are sissies. No, 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 no. Jesus wept. You see a dimension of God that he can weep. Ladies, quickly forgive. God has been forgiving you. Ladies, can easily be, you know, cheated or misled on something. You tell them this, they'll forgive you. You tell them that, they'll forgive you. Tomorrow you come again, hey, they'll forgive you. Let me ask you, are you not acting the same way with God? We come to God today, Lord, Mandalabaya, forgive me today. I have sinned. I'll never do it again. God forgive us. Tomorrow, we trick him. We go back to the same thing. When we come back to him, doesn't he forgive us at the same time? That's why I'm telling you, these things that we portray are the same qualities in God. God is just allowing us to see it in your friend, in your neighbor, what God is really like. Are you following? Yes. So there are clear differences between men and women. And the science has begun to acknowledge it, actually has confirmed it several times. It's already in the Bible, but science also has confirmed it many times that ladies and men are different. So what you need to know is, what is the framework? What is the framework that God did, the design of God for the man, the design of God for the woman? And then you see how you can work with that. You see the differences and how you can work with it. You find out, why is this like this? And how can I work with it? That's what brings the best. It's not just a matter of saying, ladies and men are different. And you stop there. No, no, no. Find out how they are different. Find out where they are different. I'm telling you, that's the reason why God intended that, you know, it happens. But I've told you times without number, it was not supposed to happen. God's plan was that children will be raised up in a house where there is a father and there is a mother. You know why? Because they needed to be educated in both. So the child ought to see the father. There are things that he learns, things that he draws. And the child also sees the mother. There are things he learns, things he draws. That was the way it was supposed to be. Hallelujah. Very, very important. And should it be, some of you, I have ever sat personally with you, maybe at an older age, and you grew up in a single parent home, whether you just grew up with your father or you just grew up with your mother, I'll tell you something. If you only grew up with your father, find a mother figure in your life. They don't have to be your biological mother. Just find a mother figure in your life. If you only grew up with your father, I mean with your mother, find a father figure in your life. Find someone that you can still look at and learn on how men are supposed to behave. You need it not only for marriage, far be it, not only for marriage, but in relating with people. You need it. Are you following? I am not against anyone growing up with just the mother or the father. These are things that happen, eh? But all I'm saying is, don't allow it that because it has happened, I will not do anything about it. Find a remedy now and say, this has happened this way. I'm going to correct it like that. Glory to God. You know, when you are able to understand the differences between a man and a woman, there are two things that happen there. Number one is that you have a standard on how a man should be like according to the Bible. You have a standard. When people say, I am a good man, what do they mean? Many people that say, I am a good man, they have got no standard at all. They just think they're a good man. I am a good woman, says who? By what standard? I am generally quiet. Is that the standard? The standard of a good woman is a woman as per a design. Design and implementation. You are implementing according to the design. That's the standard of a good woman. The standard of a man is the one that's operating according to the design of a man, according to the Bible. Are you following? Let's look at some differences from the Word of God. And I repeat, as I'm looking at this, don't only think marriage only. You also need this as a leader. You need this as a parent taking care of children. You need this as someone that deals with different genders. You need it. The ones that I present to you may look like generalizations, but still, okay, there would be generalizations with differences between one person and another. So, for example, me and me and Jack, for example, we are both men. There will be every aspect in terms of the umbrella of it, it will be the same. But within the umbrella, there may be, you know, differences, there may be degrees of how I, you know, reveal this more than that. That's what now defines the individual personalities of people. All ladies are more or less the same according to design. But one lady may be different to another. And these differences often come because of background, because of exposure, because of what someone taught you. For example, if someone told you, no, as a lady, don't behave that way, they can suppress the way you should behave. 20 years later, you may behave differently. And you may say, no, me, I'm a lady, but I don't behave like that. Not because you were supposed to behave in this contrary way, but because at a certain stage in your life, that was suppressed. Okay? Are you there? Tell neighbor, these are important things. You want to be a leader in life? And I'll tell you, no one can be great except you end up being a leader. There's no one that attains greatness as one man. As one person, you can only achieve that much. If you want to achieve so much, it will need you to work with people. Leadership comes in. No one can be the most paid in an organization except he's a leader of others. That's what happens. Anywhere, if you want to rise to the top, you have others under you. And I'm saying, this subject is important for you, even just to understand those that are under you and be able to work with them. Because the other time we looked at from the perspective of the men, let's today look at it from the perspective of the women. And we look at a few things there. Ephesians chapter number 5, verse 25. The scriptures I'm using talk about husband and wife. But I'm telling you, it's not even about husbands and wives. It's about men and women. Ephesians 5,
verse 25. The Bible says, husbands, love your wives. Write the number one difference there between, we are looking at women. So one difference, women from men. Number one is a comparatively deeper desire for love. A comparatively deeper desire for love. In other words, men also want to be loved. But the way women want to be loved is greater than the way men want to be loved. That's why the Bible says, husbands, what should you do? Love your wives. To what extent do women want you to love them? They want you to love them to the extent that even as Christ also loved the church. How many things do you ask from God every day in the name of Jesus? In the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, today give me this in the name of Jesus. Give me this in the name of Jesus. That's the way the women would want you to love them. Even as friends, I've noticed that even as friends, ladies want you to do them many favors. Have you noticed that? Even just as friends. Yeah. Most of you men, you have noticed, if you have a lady that is a friend, you can easily get a phone call like, you know what, I've got something at the bus stop. Can you just pick it for me? You can get requests like that, isn't it? Men, haven't you ever seen things like, oh, you are traveling to Dubai. Ah, just buy me this computer. I'll give you this one. And they're not saying it for anything. They just think it's normal. He says it gets to a level that even as Christ, hey, Jesus sacrificed, isn't it? So ladies would want you to sacrifice for them. Laying down everything for them. That's what they want. That's why the picture of a lady, when most ladies see a man, the picture is the picture of a hero like. And it doesn't mean that they are weak or anything. Uh-uh. That's just the way God made them. It's the same thing that's why, hey. Do you know that the Bible calls us the bride of Christ? You know what the Bible is telling us? The Bible is telling us, the things you see in ladies, whether you think they are weak or whatever, that's how I, God, want you to behave towards me. Let it soak. You men that say, you women, you are weak. God says, that's how I want you to behave to me. Come to me as weak. That's a clear picture. He said, the church is the bride of Christ. Christ is the husband. The way the lady looks at the husband, that's the way you must look at Jesus Christ. You will never say again bad things about ladies. Because that's who you are in relation to God. And then the way you treat your wife or a lady and she's complaining, it's also a message. God is telling you, if I treated you that way, hallelujah. So what do women define love as? Very, very important. Because what men define as love is very different from what women define as love. Women define love in terms of time, attention, and care. Women define love in terms of time, attention, and care. Or anything that represents time, attention, and care. So if you give a lady your time, the lady interprets it as, he loves me. She loves me. When you give a lady attention, the lady interprets it as love. When you give the lady care, the lady interprets it as love. That's the way it happens. For men, time, attention, and care may not communicate the same. To a man, I told you last week, men often look at things in terms of respect and honor. To a man, if you respect your man, You respect your husband. The husband says, she loves me. Men don't define love in terms of time. So, for example, you as a lady, you come there. You are sitting. And you think that by the end of the day, the husband will say, she loves me. No, they don't look at it that way. They look at it in terms of, my wife, can you do this? And you do it. My wife, this. And you show that you honor your husband. Once you do that, the husband says, hey, my wife loves me. On the other hand, the lady doesn't look at it in terms of you honor her, you salute to her, and then she'll take it as love. No, no, no. The lady looks at it in terms of time. Are you able to give her time? When she's talking, are you able to give her attention? Are you able to show care for her? That's what she considers love. I'll tell you, even in church here, it's the same. When a lady says, Pastor, I just want to explain something. You say, yes, please, you can send it. And when they send it, you acknowledge, say, hello, I have read, I'll come back to you. That means so much to the lady. Why? You have shown attention. You have given them time. To a man, it's another thing. A man may be more honored if I said an example like, Pastor Mpaso, please stand. Come here. And I made him, I said, stand here. And I said, you know what? All of you, Pastor Mpaso is a great man. This is one of the great men that we have in this land. And I'll tell you, you'll be feeling good like that. Very different from Minister Angela, come, stand here. This is one of the great women we have. She will not feel the same way that he will feel. She is very successful. Yeah, but it won't feel as much as, which I'll come to later, if I said, she's very considerate. She's very understanding. She treats us like a mother. For her, it will matter more. Not that the other success doesn't matter. Have you noticed most ladies either introduce themselves as, I am a wife, I am a mother, I am blah, blah, blah. Have you ever seen any man that has ever introduced themselves as, I am a father, I am a husband, and I am, I don't know, have you ever seen any man that introduced, you know, I saw on someone's status, like there, I think it was Pastor Victoria or somewhere on Telegram, and said mother, wife, and minister, something like that. Like, I thought about it. I said, as men, me, I've never told people that I'm a husband, I am a father, I am, as man, what are you doing? Who are you? You just go and say, I am an accountant, I am an administrator, I'm a businessman, I am blah, blah, blah. The lady, I am a mother. Is any one of them wrong? No, they are not wrong. It's just telling you the differences that are there. So, if you are a man and you are dealing with him as a man, what do you think are the stories to start? How is business going? How are things working? How are you pushing in life? When you are talking to a lady, how are your children? How is life going? I'll tell you... I'm telling you as a leader, I work with you. You will see me, I will ask, if I'm talking to a lady, I'll ask you things that concern your life first. How are things working with you? You know, I say, I know I'm good. You know, you're happy, everything's going fine. Ah, yes, I'm fine, fine. Okay, what about that report? When are you, it works fine. If you're going to Pastor Mpaso and you start asking questions like, how is Minister Catherine? You know, it just look. Like for me, I'll tell you, I meet many people. Very few ever ask me, like men, very few ever ask me how Pastor Emma is. Somehow, we are able to talk without asking each other about wife, children. Yeah. Most men, whenever you meet people, do you always talk about your siblings? Are you married? You're not? You have siblings? Like brother, sister? Do you ever meet many men? Anyone that's your friend? Is your friend? Do you ever meet and you ask him, how are your brothers? Like you see, he's even laughing. Like you see, it's a question you can't ask. But ladies, can you ask, how is your sister? You see what I'm talking about? To be a good leader, understand that men are different from women. I'm not even talking about a husband, wife. That is number three. But just to work well with people, understand that they are different. Are you there? Clap hands for them. So I was saying that ladies, look at love in terms of what? Time, attention, and care. Men, when you give a lady money, it communicates something. If you give it and she looks at it as care, she's going to love it. But if you now come to a level where you are just dumping money to her, so she's your wife, you are just dumping money to her, and you are never at home, that same money she loved yesterday, she won't love it. Why? Because she will now look at it as there is no attention. Do you know why, as men, you must listen to stories of your wives, even if you are not liking them? Because it's what it communicates. You're listening to a story. Listening, even if you are. And you know, there are many men that don't like stories. I am one of them. But you know, sometimes you still listen. Where you listen is to show that I can give you my time. Are you there? So men, actually, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13 from verse 4. Do you know why ladies like gifts? Gifts communicate attention, communicate you value them. They communicate. You are able, they communicate that you went to a shop, bought them a gift, and you gave them. Well, how do you do it? You see? So it looks like you went to a shop. You bought. You thought of me. You see the way it looks? Men, someone buying you a gift, it doesn't communicate it that way. You see? That's why I'll tell you something. Women, contrary to public opinion, women don't necessarily want expensive gifts, as it may be. They want you to show that you put time and effort into it. If you can just be given small sweets every day, they will still appreciate it. Men may not like the gift aspect as per se, but men think in terms of need, necessity. Let's sort out the matter. My car tires are not working. You buy me tires. Great. Powerful. You have solved the problem. You see the way they look at it? The problem has been what? Solved. I'll come to it. Men are obsessed with problem solving. If you want to do well with a man, help him to solve his problems. And as you're helping him solve his problems, don't make him look like he's a problem. Are you there? Okay, let me just look at this one and I'll look at one more on problem solving and we close it for today. Is it helping you? Yeah. So women want to feel loved, my friends. Even in church, they want to feel loved. They want to feel special. They want to feel cherished. Some say, are women special? No, they are not special, but they want to feel special. They are not special as in comparison to me. Like, you see, I said they are not special. Have you seen something? But if I said, women are special. Have you seen some? That's the way they would want to feel. And I'll tell you something. It doesn't matter what age. I have a mother. Even in her old age, these traits, I still see them there. It doesn't matter who you are dealing with. First Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 4. First Corinthians 13 verse 4 from the NLT. The Bible says, love is patient. Ladies want you to be patient with them. Men, are you following? Love is kind. Ladies want a lot of kindness. Are you listening, you men? He says, love is not jealous. Ladies don't want you to be jealous with them, but they can be jealous one with another. Jealous, not boastful, not proud, not rude. Ladies don't want you to be rude to them, but they can be rude to you if they want. He says, love does not demand its own way. Ladies don't like a position where every time it goes in your way. Sometimes just make it go their way. They will appreciate it. Ladies, have you seen how it feels when a man says, no, I think I'm wrong. You are right. It feels so good, eh? Men, it may mean very little. He says, it does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Love is always hopeful. And I'll tell you, women are very hopeful. Love endures through every circumstance. These are some things that you must look at and develop each one of these as you are dealing with the ladies. Let's pick one more in the interest of time and we close. The second thing I said is another difference, is the difference between emotions and logic. Emotions versus logic. Men are generally logical, linear, rational. That's the way men think. On a general note. Women, it's not only about logic, it's not only about ration. Women bring in empathy. Women bring in being considerate. Women bring in what you call intuition. Have you ever heard many women that say, you know what, I just feel it is wrong. You know what, me and Pastor Emma, we have had a lot of this. Until these days, I've just given up. I'm telling you, we have had a lot of this. I'm saying, Pastor Emma, this should be the way. Because of A, B, C, D, E. And she says, me, I just feel like. And I'm saying, you know what? Me, I'm saying, it's like this. And I even sometimes bring data, evidence. According to this, it works like this. According to this, after you present all that data, then she still goes with, I just feel like it is wrong. And you know what? Sometimes they are right. You know, when a lady is stopping you from doing something, you are a foolish husband if you just continue on it and like you just continue. Julius Caesar died when the wife had said, don't go. That's how Julius Caesar died, isn't it? Julius Caesar said, I will go. The wife said, the dream I had, what I'm thinking, my husband, don't go. Julius Caesar, you know, there's Brutus, these are my friends. He rationalized it. I'm protected, I am not, this cannot happen, blah, blah, blah. Judas went and died. Many men have failed in business over their ladies that said, you know what, I just feel you are taking this too far. The man, no. And then they made a big mistake. Are you there? So ladies, think in terms of you bring in empathy, you bring in understanding, you bring in men, think in terms of he is wrong. The thing is, he is wrong. Let us think in terms of, yes, he is wrong, but yesterday he did us a good thing. Therefore, let's treat him like this. That's the way let us think. I'll tell you, that already brings a very great problem when it's ladies and men working together on something. And even husbands and wife, the same comes in. Men want to solve problems. And men always think that their wives want them to solve their problems. That's what men think. Men always think in terms of, I can help her solve her problems. Even when the wife feels low, moody, men think in terms of, she may have problems that I need to solve. On the other hand, ladies are not looking at to solve their problem. They are looking at, can you show care? Can you show love? Can you show attention? That's why men, I'm telling you, a good number of the problems ladies are telling you, they don't want you to solve them at that time. They just want you to what? To listen. That's all. Me, I'm telling you, in my house, I've been solving many. Yeah, like everywhere, you just bring solutions. Eh? Not that they don't want the solutions. They want the solution, but sometimes it's not at that time. Like if a lady comes to her and says, today work wasn't good, the way my boss shouted at me. The response is not, you know what, when your boss shouts at you, they are, according to biology, there are ways to handle that boss. Okay, what did you respond? What did you say when the boss shouted at you? I just looked down. Ah, that's the problem. You should not have looked down. You should have said, boss, I apologize. Can you take your phone now? Call him now and say you are sorry. You see the way men think? They are sorting the problem. Women at that time, they just want you to come and say, that's why ladies are good at hugging each other and cry. Ladies can literally say, things are not working well in my life. I feel somehow I'm going to my best friend for an afternoon. Ladies do that. Men, Dr. Mongoja, have you ever felt in a sitting room and just said, I'm going to sleep over at my friend's place? Like, ha, 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 ha. Hey! Me, I don't even remember any day I slept over anywhere to discuss. I went to sleep over to sort problems, and we sorted them in prayer. We planned the whole night. We drew things. We analyzed. We read. That's what I know. But I don't remember a day I ever had a friend and we sat overnight, the whole night, to discuss the problems, and then he... patting each other in the back. What about when it comes to church? It's the same. You know, even in church, women will bring you situations that they don't want the answer at that time. So when Minister Shireen, for example, is coming to Pastor Beatrice and saying, Pastor Beatrice, things in the worship team are not working so well. The thing is, the solution is just appoint. You have now missed it. Sometimes she's just expressing it. And she just wants you to hear and say, canon. You know, it is well. That's a, what is that? No, Minister Zaitu. So Minister Zaitu is like, I say, yeah, she's like that. All right. But God is with us. And the story ends what? There. Note, number one, reorganize the team. Number two, they put a conference next week. That way you have lost her. Whereas, when you're talking to a man, Pastor Fraser, and you're talking, Pastor Fraser, how is the campus going? And he says, it's not going good. Discuss the problem. How can we change results? That's what will matter. Are you following? So logic versus what? Empathy, being considerate, and all of this. That also brings you to feelings, isn't it? If as a man, the lady speaks something and you cut in, bring solutions, it invalidates the fact that you have got lovely feelings for her, or you consider well of her. She looks at it as, he doesn't care about my feelings. That's why many women complain on, he doesn't care about how I feel. Have you noticed that statement? Many women, many wives will complain of, he doesn't understand how I feel. He doesn't understand how I feel. Why? Because the feelings matter a lot to them. Okay, let me just pick one more, very quick one. Is on talking or communication. The most frequent complaint of women when they want to complain about men is what? Men don't. No, you are right. Just say it out loud, ladies. Men don't. They don't hear, they don't listen. Ladies always look at it that way. Men don't listen. You can search it on internet. That is one of the number one problems that many women complain. I have counseled many couples. One great concern of many women is men don't listen. He doesn't listen. He doesn't listen. I tell him this, he doesn't listen. I tell him that, he doesn't. He doesn't. Have you ever heard this one? He doesn't call me. He doesn't text back. He used to text me at some time. These days he doesn't. And then they start thinking what? He may be cheating. He doesn't text. Have you also heard the one of, he doesn't status me. You know, I was just helping a certain married couple a few weeks ago. And out of the several situations that we are handling with, one of them that came up is that the man doesn't status the wife. And the man said, status? Like, I told the man, I said, hey, start immediately. Yeah, so he started. Actually, we had an assignment that same time, that soon after this meeting, you status. And it was a planned one, but guess what? Even the planned one, the wife was very happy. Wives enjoy it when you somewhere status them, or you somewhere text them, or call them. Men, it's not really that way. Like for me, for example, I wouldn't really mind. I'm saying between one man and another, there could be differences. Eh? But for me, I wouldn't mind if Pastor Emma didn't call me for 5 hours and we were working. She was working, I was working, and just like that. Papa, and 5 hours went. I wouldn't mind. It wouldn't even be a statement of, she has stopped loving me. She doesn't like it. It wouldn't matter. I know that after these 5 hours, we will meet. But many women complain when they go to work. You remember the married couples discussions when we have them on the group? Women always say, hey, the whole day, they don't text us. They don't text us the whole day. Pastor, they don't talk to us. Just imagine someone doesn't talk. You leave each other at 7:30. Pastor, just imagine. The person doesn't talk to you. And me, I can't imagine it. See, Pastor, just imagine. He doesn't talk to you the whole day. Or even per lunch, Pastor, you wait. That maybe it's lunch hour. He will remember you. He will call. He doesn't call. Then even the whole, Pastor, the whole afternoon, he has traveled. He hasn't called. Those are some things that marriage counseling, those are the things we are sorting out, I'm telling you. When he travels, he doesn't even call. He doesn't even do this. He goes outside the country, doesn't remember us and the kids. Very different from a lady. When a lady travels, she will call the kids. Hello, how are you? Blah, blah. Are you there? It's very simple to lead a successful marriage life. If you just have knowledge on these things and other things, I will finish on this topic next week. We finish on it next week, and maybe we look at other things from there. But these simple things, I know these are not topics that when you're teaching people, it's like, okay, they are even looking at it as very, very spiritual. But I'm telling you, it's very spiritual. You see, the build-up of a Christian must be well-balanced. If you just have results in prayer and you don't have results on dealing with your wife, that's why some have ended up, you have got a successful ministry, but then the marriage is not working. It misrepresents things. You end up, you have got a business that is working. You are a success there, but this area is not happening well. A person must be properly balanced. And if you are well balanced, it also helps out on the spiritual things. If you have got quarrels in your family every day, even your prayer life will be affected. Isn't it? It will be affected. And the Bible is telling you the solution is very simple. Handle them, walk with them according to knowledge. Ladies, develop their left side faster, which is the side of being considerate, empathy, but also talking, communicating, you know, arts and all of that, the left side of the brain. Men develop quicker on the right side of the brain. And the right side of the brain is where there's analytical work, where there's mathematics, problem solving, and that. They develop faster in that space. That's why ladies are very good at vocabulary. Ladies are very good at languages. Many ladies read faster than men. A lady can learn how to read by the age of 3, 4, and, you know, they know how to read a lot of things, 5, 6. You may find men maybe are struggling at that age. Yes, there could be exceptions, but I'm saying in comparative sense. So because women develop a lot on that side, they want someone to talk to. You are not a good leader, Minister Maureen. You are not a good leader of ladies if you never give them your time to explain to you their issues. Period. Pastor Mbaso, you are not a good leader of ladies if you never create time that they can explain to you their matters. And you are not a good leader of men if you don't help them to solve their problems. One of their critical problems of men is what? Is what? Is money. You know why money? Because money communicates honor. Money gives them a sense of esteem. A man with money walks like that. A man with no money feels low, feels as a low self-esteem, feels they can't talk, feels that a man with money may not even know English, but he'll be making his speeches in English. A man with money will easily feel confident to come everywhere and say, ah, there, let's just do this when you have money. No money, they feel low self-esteem. That's why helping men to have money, very important. Stand up on your feet. You meet men for counseling. Almost, you are unlikely to meet a man that tells you, I'm offended. This one didn't speak to me well. He was gossiping about me and I didn't like, those are some things they sort out. When you meet a man, they are bringing problems that you need to solve. Ladies, yes, would also bring problems you need to solve, but ladies can also have their own. She didn't speak to me well. He didn't do this for me. He doesn't appreciate me. In RFP, we are not appreciated. They don't consider us. You see? Ladies want One last example, then we pray. When I started out in ministry and would go to preach at a place, it was total military. You start off, maybe we are fasting, or even if we are eating, but will not eat. Just drive. No need to stop anywhere. For what? Go all the way. Preach. Finish. Drive back. Everyone goes to their home. And it was fine. When I got married, that quickly changed. That's now I started yelling. We are starting off, Pastor, after the service, as we're going back to Blantyre, so we just send people to Crossroads to buy pizza. I said, what? Pizza what? Let's just go. Like, somewhere along the road, we may find Super Shake and... No. People need to eat properly. I said, ha! So that's when now these logistics started. The logistics I don't enjoy up to today, but I'm a full member of them. The logistics of, we're going to eat like this. We can't just do this. People must. Let's stop by Nchewu and do this. Then buy a lot of. But you see, when you're working with ladies, that is important, isn't it? That's why most branches, they would give me food back in those days. You go to a place, they give you food. Sometimes I'll just say, I know it's fine. Don't worry. And I would come. These days, I'm expected to receive it, sometimes to eat there, to show that I am appreciating the food. And the food is often coming from the women, isn't it? Yes. They'll bring you cakes. You must show that you like the cakes. If you're fasting, still eat them after. And once you give feedback that the cake was nice. Hey! Like you create a revolution of cakes. Like you have broken through. You keep receiving. But I'm saying this for a reason. As a leader, this is important for you. Are you following? Go ahead and talk to the Lord. Go ahead and talk to the Lord. That the Lord is helping you to understand these differences between men and women. Pray that the Lord is helping you and that you are using these differences positively. You are using them as a leader. You are using them in your family. You are using them in your business. You are using them in your finances. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, you are